So, hello everyone, I'm Paul. I'm a certified ethical hacker. That's just a certification, doesn't really make me a hacker. But I've done some pen testing, quite a bit of it. And I thought that it's customary, you know, we see the talks at DEF CON and other places, customary to talk a little bit. You know, the hackers brag about themselves in the first slide. I am actually going to say what I'm not. Okay, so. Hardcore hacker, dangerous dude, hacking any computer systems without authorization, exposing vulnerabilities on Twitter for fun. Love media attention, live for the retweets of my hacks, and actually that one maybe a little bit is true. And of course, why not? Profit from attacks, right? So that is not who I am, okay? So just making that clear. And but many people are tempted to be that person, to get that persona, to make people think that's who they are, right? I have this cheesy picture from Matrix, from the Matrix, but it's kind of started our culture, right? Hacking is considered cool, it's super cool, right? You see it in the media, you see it in the movies. In cyberspace, actually, hacking is kind of like a superpower, right? You're able to bend the rules of the system, right? Hacks are like magic tricks. I love going to DEF CON and watching people hack all kind of devices, and you know, they just go in, they go show a login page, boom, put something in it, they bypass it. Wow, so cool, right? The modern culture glorifies the hacker, right? So you got the show, the TV shows, you got that hoodie persona with 10 screens, and you got Neo, you got Mr. Robot, and so on, right? So people get, especially young people, right? Young security researchers, they get the impression, you know, that this is super cool to do, and the line between good and bad is quite blurred, right? So. And easy to cross. And, well, everyone, including myself, enjoys breaking the rules sometimes. So just to be clear, any unauthorized access to a computer system is illegal. So, and I don't know if you knew, but even passive reconnaissance with the intent of hacking is considered illegal. So if you doing some doxing about somebody, you know, to find the answer to their security questions, that's hacking. That's illegal, unauthorized testing. You can definitely still perform hacking and pen testing in an authorized fashion with proper safety measures, and that is known as pen testing, security research, white hat hacking. Also, causing harm indirectly, from a computer activity can be grounds for legal action, right? So you can have things like negligence, irresponsible disclosure of a security bug that could cause harm to people. And, you know, okay, that's just the law, right? Those are the rules, law are boring, right? But I feel deeply that it's immoral to, you know, conduct any reckless cyber attack or security disclosure causing harm to people, right? So it's unethical and immoral. And you see what happens with full disclosure of 0 days, like WannaCry, right? And then, right, getting your computer attacked by a ransomware or wiped out is bad, right? It's, you're losing your pictures, you're losing money too. But in the world of IoT, you know, more and more Internet of Things, you know, you got your car connected to the internet, you got all kind of devices, fridge. You can imagine you driving to a pole because your car's operating system got hacked by a 0-day someone or something like that, right? So nowadays we've got to be really careful with hacking. So types of hackers, probably know this already, got the black hat. These are the cyber criminals. They work in the shadows and they're out for profit. Then you got the gray hat, and here There is actually legal companies that will bid for security bugs and sell them too. Well, I'm just going to go really quick and we'll keep the questions for the end, okay? So we'll sell the bugs to the highest bidder, including governments, you know, so they don't really care. And then you got the white hats. The white hats are the good guys, security researcher, pen testers, right? These are people who abide by the law, following the rules of responsible disclosure, and having fun breaking the rules, but without causing any harm. So, I thought that it would be interesting to go over two case studies of actual, you know, hackers who attacked production servers, actual sites, caused damage, got in trouble for it, and actually made it into the media, and had their own Wikipedia articles. You know, this is all us, so I tried to find web application security hacks. So one of the most famous hacks of all time is the SAMI worm. And this is actually the fastest spreading virus of all time. It's a very original virus, but it is categorized as a virus. It was released in 2005, infected 1 million users in 20 hours. The virus bears the names of its creator, Sami Kankar, who, if you don't know him, is a famous security researcher. And at the time, he was just a 20-year-old entrepreneur, genius type. He dropped out of school and founded his own company. And he was just, I guess, looking to expand his social network in innovative ways. What he did, he used Tor cross-site scripting to infect MySpace. You guys know what MySpace is. It's generation-wise Facebook. And this was the first self-propagating XSS worm. Right? So practically what it would do, it display, but most of all, Sami is my hero, and then would update the profile of whoever saw, you know, this page with the payload. Then whoever saw those people pages, they would get infected and so on and so on. And it spread like wildfire in 20 hours, right? So this was relatively harmless, but Sami landed in hot water for it. He got raided by the Electronic Crimes Task Force in 2006. He entered a plea agreement to a felony charge, sentenced to 3 years probation, allowed only one computer and no use of internet, 90 days community service. I think the part where he wasn't allowed the use of internet, I think that must have hurt the most. So there were repercussions to this attack, right? The other one I want to talk to you about occurred more recently, and it was the AT&T iPad data breach. This happened in June 2010. Conducted by the GOATSEA Security Hacker Collective. So the previous attack was cross-site scripting. This one was a missing authorization attack. So practically what they did, they found that you could fuzz the ID of you know, the iPad on an AT&T page and enumerated 100,000 K information for including celebrities and politicians. And then what they did is they were looking for fame and sent all the exfiltrated data to Gawker Media before notifying the impacted company, which is AT&T, right? They did that because they felt, you know, just notifying the company would not get them recognized, would not, you know, make them famous. The main representative of the organization, Andrew Ornheimer, also known by Weave, was the guy that pretty much conducted this. And the case ignited a debate on responsible disclosure because they practically did notify one of the issues. But the way they did it wasn't right. Right? So They said that they notified the TF first, but that's, you know, that was a matter in the trial. The repercussions is that we've ended up in jail, sentenced to 41 months of federal prison. It was, you know, quite a big deal. Ordered to pay $73,000 in restitution. He was freed after 1 year, after his legal team appealed the case. So a bit of a few conclusions from this case studies. So Sammy is undoubtedly a very gifted security researcher, right? But you can imagine, 20 years old, he must have thought the cross-scripting flaw he found was cool, nice proof of concept, let's try it out. Then it got out of hand, right? He did not follow industry best practices, got in trouble with the law, right? And he has since produced some amazing research. And he's routinely talking at DEF CON and other security conferences, but he's done it legally, right? Weave and his friends were just looking for media attention, but that they had to pay a hefty price for it. And you know, there are better ways to disclose security vulnerabilities and still get reputation, right? If you do it the right way. And truly publicly shaming companies for having security issues, I don't feel it's ethical. It's easier to break something than to build something. So a few rules for pen testing. So for the ones of you who are pen testers, make sure that all security tests of a computer system are authorized. It's important to get the authorization in writing. You have a statement of work. And then if you are planning to participate in bug bounties, be careful reading the terms of the bounty. You know, some of the things are causing a negative impact on the system, and notify the company security team as soon as you have something. If you are an independent security researcher, you may want to contribute to improve security for all of us by identifying bugs in commonly used software, like open source software, OpenSSL, WordPress. But the disclosure of a security bug should follow a rigorous process. So here's a few things that you need to consider. Obtaining a CVE, the way you communicate with the vendor, the open source maintainer, keeping a record of all the events, all the communication, all the timelines, and whether you should do a full disclosure or not. So how do you go about getting a CVE? You contact MITRE. Well, there you don't even need to contact them. There's actually a page where there's a list of CVE issuers. You can Google it. And the list includes many major software vendors, Microsoft, IBM, they're all CVE issuers, and the contact information from those companies' PCERT teams, so the product security and the response teams, is on that page. So you can just contact them directly, report the security incident, get a CVE number assigned, and work with them to resolve the issue. Having a CVE will ensure that the zero day is properly tracked, that you have vulnerability scanners scanning for it and reporting it properly, getting the CVSS scores, so proper risk for it, and you know, people can inventory it and track it. If you don't find the company as a CVE issuer, you can look on their website, try to find the report security issue section. Most vendors maintain such a section. Or alternatively, you can contact their support team. In the case of OSS, contact the maintainer, but be careful, don't create a Git bug or anything like that, because you don't want to make the POC or the vulnerability details public until the issue has been resolved. Be helpful in assisting the vendor. I've dealt with many security researchers over the years, and so I've been on both sides of the fence. Some researchers are not helpful. They're not very cooperating. So be as helpful as possible. It's going to be good for both sides. Be clear regarding the deadlines to disclose the bug. So sometimes companies can drag the bug for too long until they fix it. So it's good to set some timelines. Some security researchers like to present their findings at security conferences. So if there's a deadline like this, it's good to let them know. Or it's good to use a fixed timeline, like say you have a 120-day rule. ZDI has a 120-day rule, for example. And you say, after 120 from notifying you, we're going to expose it. Right? So you have enough time to fix it. Now, there's people who want the issue fixed sooner than that. Be patient. If it's not there shattering, that amount of time is not that long. If a company refuses to address the issue, this can happen. Right? Or they're just unresponsive. There is an organization in US, CERT. US CERT, you can contact them to do mediation with the companies, and they will, you know, they'll help you. Don't contact the media. And once contact was established, use encryption to report any proof of concept to the vendor. And yes, do not expose the issue until a fix is available. And very importantly, keep a detailed record of all the interaction with the vendor, including the dates. And if you guys are monitoring the full disclosure distribution list, you'll see that researchers do this all the time. They'll send an email, they say, we found this issue, and here are all the timelines. We might find the vendor on this date. They contact us back. They said they're going to fix it at this date. So you see the whole history of the issue. So once the fix is out, it's your time to shine. You can contact the media, email the full disclosure mailing list to let other researchers know about the issue, make people aware. You can present at conferences, blog into it about the issue. But be sure to include the full record of the disclosure in your release. Be careful what you disclose. If the issue may impact millions of people and cause loss of life, right? Maybe you don't want to disclose the proof of concept. And there's a whole public debate on the risks and advantages of providing the exploit details, right, versus keeping the details secret. Sometimes having the exploit details will help people to find and test the issues, so it's useful, right? But you have to be able to weigh the risk. And that's all I had.
You said once the fix is there, it's okay to disclose. So wouldn't it be more practical to wait 6 months or some amount of time to disclose something that's important at your system? Like I have servers running from like very old versions of SSH and stuff like that.
Great question. And so the question was, shouldn't the researcher wait about 6 months before disclosing the issue to give people the opportunity to patch? And what I prefer is to disclose there is an issue and the severity of the issue without the details. That's what, like I've always done it this way. And so that's the debate, whether you full disclose or you just say there's an issue and you don't disclose the proof of concept. But disclosing it as soon as possible is very important, because then people know that the firewalls firewalls won't help, IDS, so on, right? They'll try to prevent the issue in other ways. Go ahead.
Authorization to do a penetration testing of an application, can you be formal? It has to be formally written down.
Formally written down, signed by both parties, absolutely, because this involves liability, right? Because it could lead to legal actions, because the people you work with in a company may not be the ones that are starting to yell at you and coming after you. It's good to have, you know, something said, absolutely. For the other one. Okay, yeah, so well, if you release a fix, can people reverse engineer the patches and find the issue? Absolutely. I know people who do that. But not everyone can do that. So it's the security by obscurity, right? So the moment you have the proof of concept out, and this is a scoring system we use, I think CVSS, they have proof of concept in the full CVSS score. So if proof of concept is available, that automatically increases the security score, the risk. Go ahead.
Would you describe what's a zero-day impact?
What's a zero-day? So zero-day is security bug, pretty much. A security bug that's never known, it hasn't been, you know, it's zero-day, so it hasn't been publicly disclosed. Let me give an example. The cross-site scripting in MySpace that I was talking about was a zero-day until Sammy Kamkar found it. That as opposed to a CVE, so now that you found the issue, you disclose it, it gets an identifier. So CVE stands for Common Vulnerability Enumerator. So it gets an identifier, so people can tag it and know what it is. Now it has a bunch of days behind it, right? So that's the difference. The 0 day is an undisclosed vulnerability. Go ahead.
If you take the case of the MFG packs, not all hacks necessarily have a cost that's related to monetary cost. G-packs, for example, can have a very, can have a life cost, right?
Yes.
And when the article came on Wired, they spoke about having done the same thing with a different company, delayed before implementing a patch, and even after the fact, and then say who that company was. Well, then you can still have billions of drivers running around with these vulnerable vehicles because this company would rather protect their reputation than a patch.
Yep. So that's a very good point. So the question was regarding the G-packs. Now we have a vehicle. There is an example of a company who delayed fixing the issue for a very long time and kept the people exposed. Right? The longer they delayed, the more people were exposed. And if the bad guys know about the issue, right, it's just they will not disclose it. They'll just use it. Right? So you have people being attacked with it. So absolutely, I agree with you. That's why I mentioned the 120-day rule. So you can just say, listen, you have 120-day from notification. We're going to say there's an issue, right? We're not going to say how we do it, but you know, like they did with when they showed the car was moving on the road, like the Chris Walsh and they showed the exploit, they raised concerns about it, right? And so the company can fix it right away. Right? So that's, I think, that's the best. There's a whole debate on how you do this, and it's complicated, right? I guess people could start a business by being lawyers or security researchers. you just have to be very careful, and that's important to me.
So these bug bounty programs by Google, Facebook, and I think Shopify has one as well. Does that mean then you're directly allowed to attack and find a bug, or are there restrictions? Do you have a website you can attack, or how does it work generally?
So usually it's their production, and there are restrictions, absolutely. No invasive testing. If you do something, don't do the Sammy Kamkar type of thing. There's going to be, like, if you look in the terms on the bug bounty, very clear delimitation of what you're allowed and what you're not allowed to do. And there's certain vulnerability types they're looking for, certain vulnerability types they don't care for.
Okay.
So, yeah, be careful there.
Okay.
So you put hacktivists under gray hat. So let's say a hacktivist is somebody breaking into websites and messing them up to put their personal message. So I guess you've downgraded them. They're not quite black hats because they're doing it for a cause, right? I just think that's the wrong thing, right? They are black hats, right? Their cause is dear to them, but somebody like Anonymous, every hack they did, they had a reason to hack that site. They're breaking in illegally. They're doing it for their own promotion. You know, their cause might be ridiculous cause. You can't just say, oh, they're only gray hats because they had a cause. They're black hats.
Okay, so to me, honestly, I don't care if they're gray hats or black hats, they're still on the wrong side of things, okay? So I don't even care for the companies who just paid for the highest bidder for vulnerabilities, right? I don't care about them either. I just like the white hat cap. That's all. I don't really care whether in the black or green or bad. Sorry, Sheriff.
Well, I just wanted to add to the plot. I mean, what do you think, speaking about the activists, what do you think of the team who hack the hacking team?
That's a good one. I don't know how we can categorize them, right?
Black hats attacking black hats.
Any other questions? All right, thanks everyone.